Hi folks, I'm Dr. Jay Chapman. Let's investigate Cape Hatteras National Seashore, one of the most dynamic geologic environments on the planet. Cape Hatteras National Seashore is managed by the National Park Service, and it was the first national seashore park established in 1937. It marked a turning point in the history and mission of the Park Service, where it was no longer simply preserving primitive wilderness unimpaired for the enjoyment of future generations. It was actively managing federal land to support outdoor recreation and making park resources available for sport and commercial fishermen, hunters, boaters, and beachgoers. Cape Hatteras National Seashore is a 110 kilometer long segment of the Outer Banks Barrier Island chain, located on the coast of North Carolina. The barrier islands separate the Atlantic Ocean from the Currituck, Albemarle, and Pamlico Sounds, which are among the largest lagoon and estuary systems in North America. Part of the reason why these sounds are so large is because they are ancient canyons and valleys that were flooded during sea level rise since the end of the last ice age. During the last glacial maximum, about 20,000 years ago, when giant ice sheets expanded across Canada and covered Manhattan,
New York is not safe anymore.
Sea level was 100 meters lower than it is today, and the coastline was located 50 to 100 kilometers farther out to sea. The lower sea level and lower base level meant that rivers eroded into the continental shelf, carved out deep valleys, and delivered lots of sediment to the outer shelf that was reworked into shorelines, beaches, and beach ridges. When the ice sheets and glaciers started to melt at the end of the glacial period, sea level rise was initially very rapid, up to 1 centimeter per year. The rapidly rising sea level broke through low points in the beach ridges and flooded the area behind them. The beach ridges were stranded and submerged and then slowly reworked by waves into barrier islands. At the same time, sediment and sand coming out of what would become the mouth of the Chesapeake Bay was transported southward along the coast by waves and currents, and this sediment helped to feed and build the barrier island system. Sea level rise since the last ice age has caused the position of the barrier islands to shift landward through time, called the Holocene marine transgression.
Which brings me to another transgression, Reverend Mother.
On average, the shoreline is moving landward about 1.5 meters per year, and geologists have used old maps to track the shoreline position through time. Because the barrier islands are migrating landward due to rising sea level, residents of the Outer Banks are continuously battling coastal erosion, which is extremely difficult and expensive to deal with. Paradoxically, many efforts to fight coastal erosion, for example, by artificially stabilizing sand dunes, only exacerbates the problem. To understand why this is the case, we need to understand how sand moves in barrier island systems. Ocean waves move up and down and cause the water beneath them to oscillate in a circular orbit. This orbit rotates another orbit below it so that we end up with a series of stacked orbits that decreases in diameter as you go down in the water column. In really deep water, the seafloor never feels the waves.
I feel nothing!
Near the coast, however, friction between the seafloor and the water slows the orbits down and they start to flatten out. In shallow water, the oscillating orbits are completely flattened, and the seafloor experiences a back and forth motion that moves sand around. The shore face leading up to and including the beach is sloped so that the waves expend energy moving sand up the slope and have less energy to move sand when they move back down out to sea. It's for this reason that during normal weather conditions, like during a beautiful summer day, there's a net movement of sand from offshore areas toward and onto the beach. During storms, bigger waves carry more energy that can suspend sand in the water column, not just shuffle it along the seafloor. Wind also pushes and piles water up on the shore face, called a setup.
If it's a setup, time to make a quick getaway!
Which results in a strong return flow that carries sediment away from the shore. This return flow often takes the form of rip currents that cut through the surf and are a serious hazard for swimmers. The sand eroded from a beach during a storm ends up being deposited offshore in sandbars. Storms don't only move sand seaward. In some cases, storm waves can break through beach ridges and sand dunes and wash sand over a barrier island and deposit it on the lagoon side, called overwash. Sediment deposited during overwash, called overwash fans, are common to see after storms and often bury coastal roads. Overwash is the main mechanism that allows barrier islands to migrate landward through time, and old overwash fans are the substrate for younger barrier islands. So if you artificially stabilize sand dunes to act as a natural dam to prevent flooding and overwash, then storms end up mainly just removing sand and don't replenish the lagoon side of barrier islands. This has caused the islands to shrink and become narrower over time. Once geologists and the National Park Service recognized this in the 1970s, they stopped trying to fight the migration of barrier islands, accepted that it was a natural process, and adopted their strategies for managing the seashore. The culmination of the shift in policy came in 1999, when the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse was moved almost 500 meters back from the coastline. When the lighthouse was built in 1870, it was already about 500 meters from the coastline, but the migration of the barrier island had caused it to enter into the surf zone by the 1980s. The lighthouse may need to be moved again in another 100 years. The lighthouse was built at Cape Hatteras, not so much to warn ships about the Cape itself, but to warn them about a 20-kilometer-long sand shoal that extends outward from the Cape, called Diamond Shoals. There have been several hundred shipwrecks on Diamond Shoals, and the surrounding area is called the Graveyard of the Atlantic.
You say it's haunted by a ghost with a hook hand!
Diamond Shoals and Cape Hatteras are the terminus of a littoral cell. Littoral cells are semi-compartmentalized segments of the coastline that contain a sediment source, pathway, and sink. The main sand source used to be rivers carrying sediment down from their headwaters in the Appalachian Mountains. Today, however, most sand is introduced to the system by coastal erosion or remobilized from the inner shelf during storms. The pathway is sand being transported parallel to the coast by waves and currents called longshore transport. At the Outer Banks, the dominant longshore transport direction is to the south. The reason it's towards the south is because waves approach the shoreline at an oblique angle. The waves push sand diagonally up the beach, but then when the wave retreats, the sand moves straight back down the slope, creating a zigzag path down the beach called longshore drift. That's why when a jetty or groin is installed on a beach, sand builds up on one side but is eroded from the other. The oblique angle of the waves also cause nearshore currents to form parallel to the beach, which create longshore bars just offshore from the beach. Sand is transported parallel to the coast until it reaches a sharp bend in the orientation of the barrier islands, called a cuspate foreland. Geologists still debate how cuspate forelands form in the first place.
It's probably magic.
But once they are established, they appear to be long-lived features. At the Outer Banks, the cuspate forelands are the capes, like Cape Hatteras. Once sand is transported south to Cape Hatteras, it doesn't wrap around the corner. Instead, it gets funneled by currents offshore and forms Diamond Shoals. The shoal is the end of the line for sand transport and is the terminus or sink in the littoral cell. The longshore transport of sand to the south also causes coastal features to migrate, like Oregon Inlet. Oregon Inlet is migrating south at over 2 meters per year. It's one of the most dynamic features in the Outer Banks. Waves and tidal currents moving in and out of the inlet create sandbars on both sides of the barrier island that are constantly shifting and can be a navigational hazard. The inlet is kept open and clear today by dredging, but without intervention, the inlet would eventually close and new inlets could form. A new inlet did form in 2003 during Hurricane Isabel, but officials decided to fill it in with sand and rebuild the road over it, against some recommendations by coastal geologists.
No one listens to me!
Oregon Inlet itself formed in 1846 during the Great Havana Hurricane, and in the last 500 years, over 40 inlets have come and gone. Bodie Island and Pea Island, located to the north and south of Oregon Inlet, are not islands today, but they were in the past when inlets cut through them. Bodie Island used to be bounded to the north by Roanoke Inlet, which was located in southern Nag's Head today, but it silted over and closed in 1811. In 1587, settlers sailed through Roanoke Inlet and established the very first English colony in America on Roanoke Island. This colony is famously called Lost Colony because when ships returned to resupply the settlement 3 years later, they found no trace of the original colonists, and it remains a historical mystery.
So spooky.
For me, the story of Lost Colony mirrors the transient nature of the Outer Banks barrier island system. The Outer Banks and Cape Hatteras National Seashore are on the move. They've been in their current position for less than 1,000 years, and in another 1,000 years, they'll be gone. Maybe somewhere in the middle of Pamlico Sound, or maybe gone forever. Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.